Welcome to chapter. A couple announcements before we begin. One, a week from today is a very special Tuesday for Concordia St. Paul. Anybody know what a week from today is? It's All Saints Day. And so a week from today, we will have the stars in for those of you who are first year students. A long time tradition here at Concordia St. Paul has been to the stars that have been putting out song. Dream Rock. I think the Bible verse and the song of it is, let's start the song. This is a special song for you, but...
Yes, it is. And first, what an honor. So thank you very much for asking me. And I think the song really sums it up. How great is our God? And often we kind of take that for granted, and our tyranny of the urges that we settle up on our schedules, we tend to forget God. And I think the song itself is peaceful, yet energizing, and really tells us and reminds us how great our God is. We should always keep that in the center of our being and our hearts.
God's word that you chose to set in 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast. It is not proud, it does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered, keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Why this is a special word?
Well, I'm sure we're all very familiar with it. If we've been to any summer weddings, probably right? It was also part of my wedding. And what it means to me is we think of it often in the human type of love, which of course is very important. But I think we've all been hurt by love also. If we've dared to love, we've been hurt by love. And I think human love can disappoint us, whether it's family or friends or significant others, or in this election season, if you love the candidate that disappointed you somewhat. But human life, human love can be disappointing, and I think we need to remember this is really about God's love. And God's love never fails. That's the last point being so important. And when all else fails us, we can rely on that. That God
And the last verse was translated a lot of ways, love never ends. I prefer love never fails, and I use that many times as a theme verse. If you'd be willing to share your life with a nutshell from your birth to this moment.
Absolutely. Well, it's amazing that. First off, this is my 30th year at Concordia. I started when I was 9, so do the math. And it looks like all of the other students in the audience are going, in the congregation are going, sometimes I can't believe it's gone so fast. Someday, believe me, you'll be thinking that too when you get to somebody like my age, how do you know that? But I grew up in the Greater Lakes area in a small town called Crosby, some of you may be familiar with that. And my parents were very involved in the Lutheran Church, so as a family we were AOC at the time, so the body was Lutheran at that time. My dad was an elder, helped build the church, and it always felt like a family. It was a small enough community that your school life and your church life and going to the grocery store or going to movies, all of it was part of a family. And if you were a parent and you saw somebody else's kid doing something wrong, you called them on it. And nobody thought anything bad of that because the phrase, it takes a village, really was true at that time. And I felt very blessed to grow up with that. I was very involved in the church, the youth group. So blessed that I had that foundation in the church when I was growing up. Really appreciated that. Then I went and did my undergrad work at Liberty State University, and in the area of communications, met my husband there. And when we graduated, I went on to Duluth and was the weather girl for WDIO. So if you can picture that, I pointed to that. Now that was the mid-80s, so Duluth was economically depressed. I mean, if you look at it now, it's completely different, but back then we didn't make a very good wage in Duluth. My fiancé at the time, which then became my husband, was called here to be the director of the cafeteria. So I think this was all fake coming around. And he lived in the apartments that were on Lexington on the corner that are no longer there. And at the time, Kurt and Janet Brandhorst were called here to Concordia to get something brand new in the state of Minnesota to help students complete their degrees. who had for some reason dropped out of school and hadn't come back yet. And this was kind of something that didn't happen before. If you had completed your college degree right out of high school, you went into the workforce, maybe you started and then maybe you had a family, etc. Usually to go back to school, you had to quit your job there. You had to take classes there in the day, so there was really no other way to go back to school. So a lot of people felt sometimes trapped in a job because they just couldn't quit their jobs economically to go back to school. So Dr. Nolmeyer had the foresight to see that this was something that we could reach out and minister to people. And so she and President Harry kind of bought a program from the university and brought it here to Concordia so that students who were working could go to school one night a week, usually from 6 to 10 p.m. in the evening. We had one choice of degree at that time, organizational behavior. And they needed to come in with about 61 credits and a quarter-hour system. And then they could complete their major in a little bit over a year. This was unheard of at the time. And Kurt and I also lived in the apartments on Lexington. And they, them and my soon-to-be husband at that time got to know each other. And he just happened to say, because we decided I'd move here because economically that was better. And he said, gee, my wife graduated with a communications degree. She's looking for a job, just as part of the conversation. And I said, we need someone to market the degree. And the rest is history. So I interviewed for the job. It was very pleasant. They offered me the job. It's kind of a funny story. And later that afternoon, I'd gone through the interview process and then I was out running some errands, and this was before cell phones, so this is really ancient now. Before cell phones, and they called my house because they had a very important question. So my husband, and we were married, my husband answered the phone, they said, well, we have this question before we can finalize the hiring process. Could you answer it for her? And she said, well, I'll try. And they said, well, what kind of Lutheran is she? Now, honestly, I didn't know there was different types of Lutherans, because I just thought Lutheran was Lutheran, and neither did he. So he hesitated, and then he said, a good one? So we tend to learn about different types of Lutherans and that. So I started 4 and 5, is what we were at that time. And now, with all the different numbering systems, we're going to 1,000. So it's been such a blessing to see that program going, be a minister, and be available for students that they can continue working, and they can complete the degrees, not even complete the graduate degrees either. And just a blessing to see that. That really is awesome.
And that's Lowell Meyer, for which Meyer Hall is named now. And that was in the South program, so
it was
probably.
It was the Concordia School of Adult Learning.
And after 30 years here at Concordia, do you think you can make a career out of it? Or?
I don't quite know what I'm going to do with my
career. I appreciate that. You've seen Concordia change. You've been involved in industry in a number of different ways. What are maybe some ministry memory you remember that's positive or a challenge in your own personal life?
Sure. Well, as I said, I grew up in a Lutheran church up in northern Minnesota, and we actually took the program from here and we took it all over the state, which I thought was also wonderful. So I actually stayed up there part of the time and went to places like the Brainerd Lakes area, Sin Club, Duluth, and even went up to the Fargo-Moorhead area, up to Beaver Falls, and so a lot of travel involved. So we had our home base there, and I continued to be active in the church there. And I would say one of the struggles, which really I think helped me grow in my faith, was, as I said, it was an ELC church, right? And then they went into the ELCA. And then the ELCA was proposing some changes a few years ago, which most of you are probably aware of. And the church body decided they didn't want to go along with those changes, and they were going to be involved with a different church body. And we had a Bible study group consisting of 3 couples, and my husband and I were part of that, and we grew very close as friends, and I think that often happens in Bible studies, when you're growing the word and you're talking about it. We did everything together. I would be here during the weeks and I would go home on weekends. I'm knowing that every weekend we did something together. So this is a very special relationship to us. When the church up there, which I still remain very active in, decided to move to a different church body, it really split church apart. And it was very difficult to see this happen, to see open fighting, really, in the church. And one of the couples out of our three couples felt the opposite that the other two did. And we lost that friendship. And it was very negative. And things were said that were very hurtful. And it was, I couldn't believe that church people could do something like that. Some of the things they were saying to the pastor. So that was very difficult. But it forced me to really try to be Jesus the skin on, as we say, to try to look beyond those differences, try to understand where people were coming from, some of the struggles that they were having, and try to reach out if I possibly could, even though I was fairly strong feelings about it also. We never did get that friendship back, and it still hurts and haunts me to this day, but I think it was a real growing experience for everyone, and the church is thriving again. So the Spirit is definitely alive there and pursued. So that would be kind of a somewhat negative experience to help me grow positive. I was thinking about that, and I thought, well, and I can point to some large positives, but I also think we lose track of the day-to-day positives that we all have. And that is, I talked to some of my colleagues in the public systems, like at the University of Minnesota, Metro State, etc. And they say, oh, you must have so many restrictions there at Concordia being a Christian school. And I tell them, actually, no, I feel freer because we can pray with people. We can say, God bless. We can, if a student comes and says, I had death in my family, or I had a miscarriage, or I'm struggling, or I'm even struggling with my faith, we're encouraged to help them through that. We're going to pray with them and be a witness for them. And at the public institutions, that is not encouragement, it's frowned upon. And so I actually think that's a great blessing that we have here. So to see those everyday miracles, to see at graduation time the students walk across the stage and they share with us their struggles in getting there, to see those types of blessings, I think, really strengthens, I know, at least my faith that, yes, we're called to be here in whatever capacity we are, and we really care about God's work.
Two more questions. One, you mentioned Lona Meyer, your faith mentors, who have been here at Concordia or North University.
I would say the pastor that I had up north, when I just described to you the negative situation that I went through, he really showed me how to be graceful in a time of conflict, because he was attacked, him and his family personally, by many people who thought was close to him. For him, and he went through a very kind of a down period, but he never lost his faith. He openly talked about it, and he would talk about it during sermons, which made some people very uncomfortable, but he did it more as being a witness that we're all hurting and we can all grow from this. So I think that really was a testament. And I would say everybody that I really meet here has been a mentor to me. Whether it's just getting through the day sometimes, which is all that they can do, or reaching out and asking for help, or praying for me, or asking really how are you doing in this situation. I think that we really are all our mentors to one another on our walk here at this
earth. And last question. You've seen a lot of changes here. We're pretty convinced there are no boring days here in Grace St. Paul, which always something to think through or pray through, or hopes and dreams, looking forward and all the changes, all the changes, hopes and dreams for Grace St. Paul.
Well, I think it's wonderful that we've had record enrollment now for the past 5 years, I think it's been. And that is a wonderful, wonderful place to be at. And I I think it allows us to minister to more people, allows us to witness to more people. But when you're growing, we have growing pains, obviously. And what I would hope is that we never lose that feeling of family. When I start a new group, with the programs that I'm involved in, we call them cohorts because they stay together through the programs. And whenever I start a new group, I welcome them into the Concordia family. Because I really do feel that's what it is. We're a family here. And by being a family, we pray for one another, we think about one another, and even if we have conflict or disagreements with each other, we still respect each other. And we even do the difficult task of, if someone needs perhaps some feedback that is difficult to hear, we give that in grace. And that, I think, is so important. And I would hope when we reach 10,000 students that we don't lose that sense of family, because I think that's so very important. And I don't think we will, because we have such wonderful family members here. We'll always have that.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Let's close with a word of prayer. Lord, we give you thanks this day for the Concordia family, for Dr. Jean Rock and some others who minister here at Concordia St. Paul. During this season where we approach Reformation and All Saints, remind us of your grace that you died on the cross to save us from our sins, that we could be sent to live forgiven. During this election season, remind us, Lord, of the clarity of your truth and your word. We live in a fallen world, Lord, that you sent your Son. You came so that we could be a witness here until you call us home. This and so much more, we pray in the name of Jesus. This day, always, in the name of Jesus, we pray.
Amen.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.